That's my normal thing too.
Welcome to our final debate of our 2012 Forsyth County Republican Party debate series. If you all would please take a seat. If I hadn't had the pleasure of meeting you, my name is Ethan Underwood. I have the honor of serving as chairman of the Forsyth County Republican Party. And we put on these debate series every 2 years to try to introduce you to candidates that are running for the Republican nomination. As always, we like to begin our meetings with the Republican Party with an invocation and a pledge of allegiance. So if you would, please stand as you're ready. Father, we're grateful for your blessings for our country, for the rights that you've given to us. Help us to be good stewards of those rights. Give our community wisdom as we select our leaders. We pray that you give those who are running for office strength, courage to do the right things, to say the right things, and to act on their voice. Watch over us in all we do. Be with our public safety personnel. We pray that you especially protect our military and keep them safe. And we pray that you be with those who are struggling with financial problems and health problems. Forgive our sins. Use us as you will. In Christ's name.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
So this is exciting. We've still got folks trickling in. But we've got a pack tonight. We've got some good debates going on, and we certainly want to get into it. Our first round that we're going to be having tonight is we have two gentlemen who were with us, one gentleman actually, one of our state representatives who's running unopposed. He is the Republican nominee. Mr. Mike Dudgeon is in Florida enjoying the lovely weather down there. But we did have Mark Hamilton, who is our state House 24 nominee for the Republican Party. He's our incumbent. And we're pleased that he's going to be coming and addressing us, telling us what his plans are in the next general assembly. So with that, help me welcome Mr. Mark Hamilton.
Ethan had asked that I come right here. He's afraid I got too comfortable sitting down. I might be here for a while. Matter of fact, I had a person a while ago when I walked up said that they can't vote for me because they don't live in my district, but if I do this in less than 5 minutes, they'll try to vote for me anyway. So I'll try to make this very short since we know that most of you are here for the debates and not to hear a politician stand up here and talk. I do want to say that Mike Dudgeon sent me an email this afternoon just confirming that he was not going to be able to be here, and I offered to just say a couple of words for him. And so he just wanted me to pass these thoughts on. And first of all, he's sorry he's not able to make it. He's on vacation, as you already heard, in Florida. And actually, the weather is wonderful. He said it turned out to be a fine time. It was a little scary there for a while. But he certainly appreciates all the great support that he receives from Forsyth County. He also wanted me to tell you that even though in the new district that he'll be taking over, running in unopposed, that he wants me to remind you that he knows where Forsyth is and knows where home is, even though he's going to have several precincts down in the county of Fulton. There's quite a few people that are going to be serving over parts of Fulton. I think he's got a little bit in Milton and a little bit in Johns Creek, but still primarily most of his district will be in the southern part of Forsyth County. He plans on continuing to concentrate on what he did this past session and that as a freshman, and that is education, which he obviously brings a wealth of information, and I've nicknamed him the chairman's floor leader because he carried a lot of things for the chairman of education, as well as deregulation, and he plans on continuing that this next year, repealing some bills and working on education. In fact, he and I are working on a couple things together in education, believe it or not. And he wants to focus on bringing high-tech business to Georgia, continuing to reach out to those companies to bring those here, and working on education funding next year. And he wants to make sure, as I do too, that as we look at the appropriations and the funding, that we continue to maintain the funding and spending level where it is now, not where it got back into back in the early 2000s because of that. Let me just tell you a little bit about myself. I'm in my sixth year, three terms, getting ready to start my fourth, and represent the 23rd district, which right now is about the third largest district population-wise in the state of Georgia, because we've enjoyed so much growth up here. My district, in fact, has grown about 82% in population over that 10 years. And so the great thing about being in a district like that, I say great thing, is it's going to shrink, which is not necessarily good, but I'm going to be getting out of Cherokee County, which is a great place. I'll lose all of Cherokee County. I'm going to lose a little bit of the northern part of this county, a little bit of the Matt and Coal Mountain precincts I'll be losing, and some other surrounding areas. But my district will be a little bit more compact, if you will, and I'm looking forward to serving those people for Scythe County, which will be the 24th district. And so I'm in the 23rd right now, and so we'll be moving over into the 24th district. All of the district numbers changed here in Forsyth County. As I mentioned, I'm on appropriations, and next year, as you know, we've had 20-some-odd consecutive months of revenue increases at the state level. Budgets, the revenue's coming back up, and so the budget is going to be improving a little bit, but that's a little bit of a misnomer because many of our federal obligations, Medicaid and other things, are going to continue to go up. And so we're going to really concentrate on, as Representative Dudgeon mentioned his comment, not allowing our spending to go back up like it had. You know, a lot of people don't realize that we had accumulated about $1.8 billion in a rainy day fund prior to this recession turndown. It was a great thing that we did because we were able to use that money to continue to pay the bills, and we're one of still 8 states that has our AAA bond rating. I'm not about to predict anything, but we've been told by the bonding agencies that it's very unlikely that by the end of the year that all 8 of those states will continue to have AAA bond rating because of liabilities that other states have. And this next year, we'll start the zero-based budgeting, which will be a great process based on the legislation we just passed. I'm chairman of Governmental Affairs Committee in the House, and we get a whole host of different types of legislation, the third busiest committee in the House. But one of the things we concentrate a lot of our efforts on is election law. Matter of fact, there was Forsyth County News Today, there was an article plus an op-ed that I just did. We've got the federal DOJ has suddenly decided to get into our business. And the basis of this, I'd ask you, if you ever negotiated a deal with a party and then that third party came back years later and sued you for doing what you agreed to do, how crazy did that sound? That's exactly what the Department of Justice is doing to us right now. One of the questions that was asked is why? Well, there's really not a whole lot of logical reasons. One of the main reasons I can think of is, guess what? We've got a Department of Justice department right now that's a little bit of trouble. And as I said in the op-ed, they need to concentrate on fixing their leaks and leave Georgia out of this because we seem to be doing a pretty good job on military voting. So that continues to go forward, but it's very likely they're going to bring some. We're going to have to make some changes if the DOJ is going to be insistent on us dishonoring the agreement we had and going after another piece of the law. Then we'll have to address that. Because what we're doing right now with military overseas voting works perfectly fine. And the military is very supportive of this, even though the Obama administration is saying we're in violation of the law. Let me tell you about a couple bills that I worked on this last year that did not pass, and I'm going to continue to move forward. One was House Bill 109, which was a bill that's going to be very controversial, be very controversial in this room, matter of fact, because what it says is that we need to quit allowing government bodies, whether it's the county, whether it's the city, whether it's the school system, taking taxpayer dollars and lobbying for legislation at the state capitol. I can tell you that when I get phone calls from school teachers, hardest definitely school teachers, but it's a great example, and I can hear the intercom in the background, and they're at school, and they're calling me at the capitol to tell me that we need to quit cutting their budget, they need more money. Something's just not quite right, how they can sit there and use taxpayer dollars to lobby for or against that. So that's what this legislation does. And it's very complicated because you would imagine there's a lot of great benefits that those people can do in the lobbying process, but we really think it's out of control. And you're going to find that as we approach the July 31st charter school referendum. Another bill that was very excited about, unfortunately didn't pass this year, and that was House Bill 855. House Bill 855 was a bill that simply says we're tired of subsidizing certain telephone companies out there. And right now in Georgia, every year we spend $20 million in tax. You don't even know, matter of fact, we did pass House Bill 323 this year, So when you start getting, after July 1st, when you start getting your phone bill and you see a tax show up on there that you've never seen before, it's not a new tax. It's just we passed a bill that now they have to show the tax. And because what we said was, if we show the tax, guess what? It's going to be harder for them then to raise that tax, or for government to raise that tax. The next step is to quit charging that tax, because when you and I pay that tax here in Cumming, guess where that money goes? It goes to other parts of the state, to the 20-some-odd telecom companies that don't do it the right way, and we're still subsidizing those companies so that they can be in the telecom business. And so, just another example of the government over the years picking winners and losers. So those are the types of pieces of legislation that I plan on working on continually, along with chairing the governmental affairs and appropriations. And it's an honor for me to serve the 23rd District. It'll be a continued honor to serve the people of Georgia representing the 24th District. And I look forward to another 2 years of doing that. And please, if I can ever be of any assistance or guidance, let me know. And as I close, I'll just remind you that during this difficult political season, there's a lot of campaigning going on. And you're going to hear lots of things that some people might say are not truthful. And I just encourage every one of you, as you listen to the candidates speak, do your homework, find out, find good sources of information, find people that are trustworthy, that will tell you the truth. You know, we live in a time when anybody can sit in their den and make up anything they want to and put it out there on the internet. And one of the reasons that I wrote this op-ed, for example, I know Mike Dudgeon has written one recently, is that what happens many times is if people see things in print, they just assume it's accurate, it's true. Well, you're going to find there's a lot of falsehoods. Hopefully we won't hear any tonight during these next two debates tonight. But if I can be of any help or assistance, please let me know. Thank you very much, and God bless you.